Jesus walks beside me, His steps show me the way. Will I follow in His footsteps in each new passing day? Will I follow His example and try to be like Him? Will I listen when He calls me and choose to follow Him? I will follow Jesus in every step that I take. I will follow Jesus in every choice that I make. I will follow Jesus. I will walk. I will follow Him. Jesus walks beside me, His word shows me the way. I will take His hand to guide me when I don't know the way. I will share His love with others and help them to find Him. I will listen when He calls me and choose to follow Him. I will follow Jesus in every step. Every choice that I make, I will follow Jesus. I will walk with Him. I will follow Jesus. I will follow Him.
Jesus walks the sea.
What a beautiful video, isn't it? But more than a beautiful video, what an important message. I will follow Jesus every day, walking with Him. It's not just a message for kids, is it? But it's a message for each of us to remember that every day we need to follow and walk with Jesus. If you don't know me, I'm Narelle, and I'm the Children's Ministry Secretary for Tasmania. So, but I'm also part of Lonnie Corps when I can get here, which hasn't been often lately. But today is International Children's and Youth Day, celebrating children and youth in the Salvation Army all across the world. So I was on Facebook last night and I saw videos of a village in Papua New Guinea and the Corps there meeting, celebrating youth and kids. And I thought, how beautiful is it that we're part of this bigger story, this bigger Salvation Army, and we get to celebrate youth and kids here today, but also the Salvation Army in Papua New Guinea, in UK, in USA, all over the world is celebrating youth and kids. And we get to lead the way because we're on this side of the world and it's not even Sunday there yet. So how good is that? So thank you for being here. Thank you for walking in and going, oh, look, we're at tables instead of chairs today. We don't have our rooms. You can blame Roderick for that, all right? But we're doing things a little bit differently because the world's a little bit differently. Kids are a little bit different these days than they were back in the day. And we do things around tables. We have discussions and chats. So we're just going to do it like this today, but we're still here to worship God. So I'm going to get the worship team to jump up, and we're just going to start by worshiping the God. And I assume there's years worth of Sunday mornings in the room, but there's years worth of people that have lived faithful lives for Jesus. So let's worship our God together. And Edwina's going to lead us in the team.
Well, Jesus has done so much for us, and he lived and he died and he rose again on high. He opened the way for the world to live again. Let's begin by praising Jesus for all he's done. I invite you to stand. To think about what you desire most in life. The words of our next song are, "This is my desire, to honour you, Lord." Honouring the Lord should be our greatest desire. 1 John 2:17 says, "The world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever." Let's sing.
Lord, we love.
All we need. Let this next song lead us into a time of prayer and be our prayer this morning. You are all we will ever need. Come reign in our hearts. Fill us with your love and help us to show this love to others. May we listen when you call us, follow in your footsteps and choose to be like you, Lord. We invite you into our hearts and our lives. Transform and renew us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody. Just some announcements for us today. So we start this week on Tuesday, 12 p.m., our monthly pizza community lunch. So if you're after a feed, come in and enjoy some company and share in the pizza lunch there at 12 o'clock on Tuesday. Don't forget, this Friday is our family movie night. Are we starting at 6 p.m.? Yeah, okay, it starts at 6 p.m. So I've got to check things sometime. Family Camp by the Skit Guys. So a nice, humorous and with a message film there. Come along, $3 will get you your movie entry and movie munchies ticket, which I think has got five goodies on it of various selections. There'll be coffee and tea available for purchase. All proceeds to kick off our Red Shield appeal there. So 6 p.m. this Friday, the 5th of May, Family Camp. So that then is leading into Red Shield time, isn't it? Come on. Woohoo! I know some of you are excited, so spread your enthusiasm around the rest of us, yep. So for Red Shield Appeal. So next Sunday is our Red Day. If you'd like, come dressed in as much red as you can or decked out as many red shields. There will be prizes. And we'll have a focus and kick off of our Red Shield Appeal there for this year. We kick off as well in the community with a big launch event this Wednesday. So I'll be praying for that as well, as quite a number of people from the community come in to hear about our services. And we've got some really good supporters on board already this year. So we're really excited about what will be happening. And give you a little bit more next week about some of the things that will take place around the city the week after. So that then means the Red Shield collecting rosters are out on the table in the cafe at morning tea time. I think there's five of them there. There's Mowbray, Kmart, Woolworths, Lagana, Bunnings, North Launceston and Prospect Vale Marketplace. Okay, so we have got a couple other little collecting spots. We're just confirming dates, but yeah, those five are there. So take a look over and yes, the willing volunteers get the best spots before I come and ask, can you fill this spot? Wednesday Fellowship this week at 1:30 p.m. So a trip down memory lane, looking at the 1960s, special things that happened to you and nationally. I did say I'll have to sit that one out because I wasn't born in the 1960s. I'm past that. But anyway, a trip down memory lane, looking at the 1960s, 1:30 Wednesday Fellowship. And if you could also let Kath know the numbers for next week will be your Mother's Day luncheon at the Lagana Tavern, 12:30 p.m. And she needs numbers by this Wednesday. So if you'd like to go along, put that in the diary and let Kath know. I think that's it. Thank you. Yes, the offering is next, isn't it? Yes. Thanks, Jan. Worship in our giving of our tithes and offerings.
Would you bow with me in prayer? Father, we just want to thank you for all you've given us this week, our health, our incomes, and Father, we just want to present to you a small token that may be used in this community. We pray, Father, that you'll bless those who have given to you this morning. Amen.
Okay, now, I'm looking for Launceston's Corps' best fisherman. Or any fisherman. We're going to have a little bit of an activity where I need a few fishermen to come out and show me if they can put a hook, a swivel and a sinker on a line for me. All right? It could be... Joe over here told me he's a fisherman. Joe, you going to come on out? Roderick, you going to come on down? You can dob in a fisherman as well. If you know there's a fisherman around, you can dob in a fisherman. Send him, oh, we've got one here. Nice. Come on, Bruce. Anybody else going to take up my challenge? I think I need a couple of kids as well. Come on down. I was going to say, I'm going to ask the kids to come down because I'm assuming something here, because when my dad taught me how to do the whole shenanigans, he also needed my eyes to help me out. So I'm assuming something. So I'm going to get the kids up here to be eyes as well, to come alongside you guys. And you're the teachers, and the kids are going to learn from you how to put a hook, a swivel, and a sinker on a fishing line. Sound good? Does anybody... Which I didn't know you could do. I'm just hoping you guys can get someone for me so when I go fishing next, I'm sorted. That's all right, the guys are going to show you. All right. Does anyone need a chair to concentrate, sit down and do it? Do you want to be around the table or grab a chair? All right, can you guys take some of them for me? If that's helpful. It's a concentrating kind of game. All right. Actually, the kids might have to hold these while the adults are... doing it. Sinker, swivel, hook. I'll give you a nice big hook. What are we catching with the big hooks? The flat hook, flat head hooks. Barra, nice. Of course. All right. So do you guys want to go one to each of the men here? You might have to hold them really carefully because they are sharp hooks. Do you want to give some string out? I might not have actually... All right. Do you want to give out some line to everyone as well? I can make longer ones if we need. Or there's a couple if you want one on each side of the swivel. All right, you can start when you're ready. So kids, if you want to hold the stuff, learn how to do it. We've got some background music to play. I know out there you're just going to have to imagine what's going on. Because fishing is thrilling work.
The human world, it's a mess. Life under the sea is better than anything.
We've got some good hooks going on.
The seaweed is always greener in somebody else's lake. You dream about going up there, but that is a big mistake. Just look at the world.
Do you need some eyes?
Right here on the ocean floor. Such wonderful things around you. What more did you look for?
All right, if you don't know, there's special hooks, special knots when you're hooking up. If my dad was here, he'd probably tell me I'd get it wrong.
Darling, it's
but you've got to wrap the cord around three times and then back through. Doesn't
slip and doesn't break. That doesn't make sense. Is there any fishing out there saying I've got it wrong?
Another piece of
wine,
here we go.
Now here all the fish is happy, as off through the waves they roll. The fish on the land ain't happy, it's hot cause they in the bowl. But fish in the bowl is lucky, they aim for a worse
that's
fate.
That's why you got the young eyes,
one
guys.
When the boss get hungry.
Yes, you go beyond the plate.
We're going all right. We've got a swivel on over here. We've got a hook going on over there.
Nobody beat us. Fry us.
Bruce over
beat
here
us.
Has got one of the Sienna doing it herself, so she's doing the second knot there, which is great. Joe's got people helping out as well.
Since life is sweet here, we got to be here naturally.
Nice. All right. I think most of us got a hook or so done.
We got to hear it, you got to hear it, under the sea. Play the harp, the place, play the bass, the sound, the job, the bass.
Ooh, we're getting it. All right. We're going to get the music to stop. The Duke of... These guys are going to keep going, and we're going to do the Bible verse while these guys finish up their knots. All right? But it's not just, I'm not going to read the Bible verse. We got it. Have we got one? Beautiful. We have a swivel on? Beautiful. All right, as these guys keep tying their knots, I'm going to read the Bible verse, but because it's International Youth and Kids Day, I know kids find the imagination a lot easier than adults sometimes. I think sometimes adults have forgotten how to use their imagination, haven't we? So we're going to do the Bible verse, but I'm going to get you to imagine that you're there while we do the Bible verse. So the first step of doing that is if you don't think your imagination's been switched on for a while, you have to reach into the middle of the table and you'll see that there's an imagination hat for everybody on the table. Can you see your imagination hat on the table? Yeah? So you've got to pick up, if you don't know, it looks like this. Has everyone got a hat like this? Yeah. So everyone picks up their imagination hat, sticks it on their head. And I want you to imagine that you're at the Sea of Galilee. Everyone got their imagination hats on and imagining that you're at the Sea of Galilee. Can I get the Bible verse up on the screen? Ooh, this is why you're imagining, because I'm the one that's going to be reading it. Let me get nice and close. All right, so remember, imagination's hats on. One day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, as you're imagining that, can you imagine, do you have shoes on? Do you have sandals on? Are you walking on sand? Are you walking on the grassy shoreline? Is it gravelly? Is it white? Just imagine, what is it like at the Sea of Galilee? Imagine that you're Jesus walking along. What can you smell at the sea? Can you smell the salty air? Rotting seaweed? No, that's good. Ooh, all right, we're going to pause that imagination because we've got some hooks here. Let's have a look. Do you want to stand up and show everyone? So we've got the sinker, we've got the hook, we've got the sinker, and we've got the swivel. Good job, guys. Now, over here, we had a little bit of trouble because it was really tricky to see, but I loved how you guys were working together and talking. And what was your name? Lucy. At one time, Joe got Lucy to help him put it through as well, which I love. I think there's something there we can learn later. And this one here, again, beautiful. That's going to catch me a good flathead when I use that one. Hey? It's got to be of size. I need to figure out what the Tassie rules are, actually. It's all changed. Awesome. Thank you guys for that. That's beautiful. You guys can head on down and sit down. Oh, put that in my hand. Awesome. I have. Thank you. All right. So, if you haven't guessed, we're back with our imagination hats on. We're at the Sea of Galilee, and if you haven't guessed from the activity, we're talking about fishermen today. So let's go back to the Sea of Galilee. We've got the sand between our toes. We've got the smell of the rotting seaweed. We've got the breeze. Can we feel a breeze? Is there a breeze today? Is it? I don't know if it's sunrise or sunset that they're out. I don't know the best time of fishing, but the fishermen are out. So Jesus was walking along, and he saw Simon and his brother Andrew throwing a net into the water. Imagine that, two brothers out fishing together. What do you think they were talking about? Were they talking about the kids at home and how they didn't get sleep the night before? Are they talking about their mum's health or their dad's health and what's going on? They're talking about what's for lunch? Yep. They're not catching anything. I wonder what they were talking about while they were sitting there in the boat. They were throwing their net into the water, for they fished for a living. Maybe this was every day, so they weren't even talking to each other. Do you reckon they were used to the smells of the ocean? They were in their home territory. They knew what it was like. Jesus called out to them, "Come, follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people." I wonder what they were thinking in that moment. It's a weird statement. I'll show you how to fish for people. And they left their nets at once and followed him. What's going on in their world that somebody walks past and says, "Come," and they go, "Sure, I'll leave my livelihood, I'll leave everything, and I'll follow." That's amazing. So the three of them then are walking up the shore. Are they feeling the sand in their feet, or are they on the grass now? I don't know. But they're walking up the shore. And they see Jesus saw Zebedee's sons, James and John, in a boat repairing their nets. I don't know, were they frustrated? Had their nets broken, or was this just routine repairs? What was going on in their world? What are they smelling? What are they seeing? Did they have a few fish in the boat already, so things were a bit slimy? They had some grime all over them. Who knows? He called them at once, and they also followed him, leaving their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men. What was their dad thinking? What were the hired men thinking? Who knows? What were they seeing? What were they smelling? It's an amazing story. A story where people were called and they followed. Let me just jump over here. My notes are over here and I'm over that side. This is a story of interruptions, isn't it? Just Jesus interrupted their everyday. Simon and Andrew had just thrown their net into the water. James and John were draped in the nets that they were repairing, and Jesus interrupted. He stepped in the middle of their lives and turned things upside down. How did the men respond to these interruptions? Amazingly, they seem to have immediately set aside their lives and followed Jesus. They put down their nets, left behind their boats, and exited the family busyness to follow Jesus. They literally followed in his footsteps. They worked together, traveled together, ate together, partied together, and prayed together. We're going to look today at the question of what does it mean for you today to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. But first, we're going to sing some more songs. So Angela and the kids are going to jump up and we're going to sing some songs. Whew. Okay, kids, up here. We're going to be on the second step today, and everyone else up as well. You know the drill. We get up here, you get up too. You should know by now. Come on, up on your feet. So our first song we're going to share with you this morning is one we have sung a couple of times before. It's called My Lighthouse. I know the actions are a little bit tricky, but join in, sing the words and listen to the message. And then we have a new one after that for you. So we'll begin with My Lighthouse.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa-oh. You are the peace in my troubled sea.
to shore.
Sunday morning as a kids' church before. We actually only learnt it last week, so we've simplified the actions. Hopefully we'll remember them. But we're going to teach you. I'm sure you'll know the words. You will know the words, but we've just chosen a nice little upbeat version. So the song is I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Fits with our theme today. Hopefully we're all deciding to follow Jesus. And our actions are as follows. The first verse, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided
to follow Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Okay? Verse 2. The world behind me, you'll have to demonstrate, girls, because I can't do it with a microphone. The world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back. Then we've just got the chorus, which you'll catch on with. We walk one way, we walk back the other. Song's done. Yeah, we're all happy. So, let's try I Have Decided to Follow Jesus.
Yeah, yeah, let's go. Yeah, yeah, let's go. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Before me, the world behind me, the cross before me.
lost before me. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning.
People joining in, so well done, you did very well. Back to you, Narelle.
Awesome. So we're talking about following in Jesus' footsteps, and I've actually asked Paul to jump up and just chat about what it is to hear from God and follow Jesus by hearing from him. So here you go, Paul.
I want to tell you a story, because I like stories. And I find that they stick in your mind more than often teaching. So listening to Jesus, following his voice, I'll always share an experience that Jan and I had some time ago when we were travelling that really taught me some lessons about listening to Jesus. Jan and one of her friends had been at a conference in Hong Kong, and because she was that close, I wanted to go to China. So I said, well, let's make it a combined trip. You go to the conference. And her husband was keen to go as well, so we'll join you at the airport in Hong Kong, and then we'll fly into China together, all of us together. It sounded like a great plan at the time, and it should have gone very smoothly, but unfortunately, it was a disaster, and I mean a total disaster. I don't know if you've ever been to Hong Kong Airport. I know a lot of you guys have travelled, but Hong Kong Airport is one of the busiest airports in the world. Like, they claim something like 75 million people pass through there every year, as well as a huge amount of freight. It's the busiest freight airport as well in the world. Well, this friend and I, we met in Sydney. I'd never met him before from a bar of soap, but he was the guy who told me he'd travelled all the, very extensively, internationally and everywhere, and would be right. He'd know what was going on. So we travelled, we got to Hong Kong, and he said, right, the first thing we've got to do is we've got to get through immigration, collect our luggage, and then we've got to go back through because China's a different country. So I said, all right, then, if you know what to do, I'll follow you. He was so confident, and I was a bit uncertain. So we got in this big, long queue, you know, 200 or 300 people got off the plane, huge queues everywhere, and we were waiting and waiting and waiting. And I'm looking at our tickets for the next flight into China, and I'm thinking, boy, this is going to be cutting it fine. And I started to get a voice in my head saying, ask for some help. Sounded a good idea, but this guy was so confident, he wasn't interested. He knew what he was doing. We just had to follow his plan. Some officials from the airport wandered past us once, and this voice kept saying, go and ask them if this is what we should be doing. Twice, go and ask them. And there's strong prompting. But I was a bit embarrassed because this guy was so sure that we were doing right. Well, then, long story short, we got to the luggage carousel. No luggage. None whatsoever. And when we raced over to find out what had happened, they told us, well, that's been booked all the way through to China. you didn't have to worry about it. So we raced back through immigrations to get back to the departure lounge. And of course, you've guessed that we got there, we were too late to get on the flight. They wouldn't let us on. It's worse than Sydney, you know, or Melbourne, where they say, oh, you know, sorry, you can't get on the flight. They meant it. They said, no, there's no way you can get on the flight at this time, even though we still had half an hour. And we found out later it was so far to get out to the flight departure that we wouldn't have been able to. And so we were stuck there in the middle of Hong Kong Airport, our flight just leaving. Our wives, well, I don't know, they were probably on the flight and gone. And we had no way of communicating with them because he didn't have a phone. He didn't need one. Of course, he knew everything. I had a phone, but it was a company one, and they wouldn't let me put international roaming on it. And so we couldn't contact them. We thought, well, we'll just have to do the best we can. And we tried to change flights, couldn't get any flights until the next day into the city we needed to be in. And even that was late in the day. So we would have missed a whole day of our tour. And they said, look, we can fly you into another town, and that goes tonight. You'll have to get accommodation there, and then you can fly on to China and catch up with your party or whatever. We tried to use the local kind of telephones, but couldn't get through to the tour guide to let her know what was going on. And in the end, we just changed our tickets, went down to the lounge to wait, and found that we had to catch an underground train, which took us to the next terminal, which was 5 or 10 minutes away underground by train. So we're sitting there just thinking, oh, well, that's it. We've lost this beautiful cruise that was supposed to be going on tomorrow. Hopefully, we'll all link up somewhere. And so I learnt right there and then that if God prompts you, you need to listen. Be careful who you rely on. And I'd made a very, very silly mistake in relying on a person because they felt they said they knew what they were doing and they were so confident they convinced me. And God's still quiet voice, the one I should have been taking notice of, I ignored, and now they ended up in a mess. Now, the other story, side of the story is that my wife, my dear wife, she's a lovely woman and she hears from God too. Fortunately, she often, or she always, obeys him when she hears him. And when the other wife and her were sitting in this terminal waiting for us guys to appear and the time was getting closer and closer to boarding, they were getting very agitated and didn't know what to do because they couldn't contact us either. They tried to ring, but no other could answer. And Jan was determined she wasn't going to go into China without me. So she said, well, we just won't go on this flight. We'll work out something else. And the other lady was very convinced that they should go back into Hong Kong and wait the night and try again tomorrow. So we, but Jan was hearing from God that, no, don't, you're not to go back into Hong Kong. And she went to the counter, she prayed about it, asked God, what do we do? What do we do? And as they went to the counter, this lovely airline lady, don't know where she came from, she wasn't at the counter at the time, but she saw him sitting there, and she said, what can I do to help you? You need help. And they said, yes, we need help. And they explained that they lost their husbands, didn't know where they were. Didn't know whether to go back into Hong Kong or fly into China or whatever. And this beautiful lady said, I will help you. I will find them. And she went over and she liaised with the people on the counter and talked. And they finally found out what we'd done. They must have been able to trace the change of flights and all that sort of thing. And she said, come with me. I will take you to your husbands. And she must have changed their flights and everything. I don't know how she did this, but she did. And she dragged them along and they had to do the whole thing, you know, go downstairs, catch the train and go off into the blue, not knowing where they were going. And at the end of them, when they popped up, she led them down this big long corridor with all the gates going off. And there were their husbands sitting there, chatting away, looking very relaxed while they were panicking their heads off. So in that situation, Jan heard God's voice And she listened. She asked for his help. And he showed her the answer. And to this day, we're both convinced that this little lady was an angel because she just took off and disappeared then. Totally out of the blue, she did an amazing job. And so we were reunited and God took over again, which was absolutely beautiful. When we got to this place, we had to find accommodation overnight. And the next day, we flew on to the China city we were supposed to be in. And there waiting at the gate was our tour guide. She had obviously been prompted to find out what had happened to these two lost or four lost Australians. And she had rearranged the whole program so that we didn't miss the tour or the cruise that we were supposed to be going on the day before. Absolutely beautiful. And we had a beautiful trip. But, you know, the two things I learned from that were that when God prompts you, you listen. And you do what he tells you to do. And right through life, ever since then, both Jan and I have experienced times when God has prompted us to do something. We've thought, that's silly. Or why would we do that? But when we've done it, we've found that that has been a God encounter that he has brought something absolutely beautiful out of. And the other thing is that when you're in trouble, don't rely on the guys around you. Pray and ask God because he's promised that he will rescue us, and he does. The whole secret is to be open and listening. Not just listening to the noise of the world around you or all the advice you've been given, but to have the confidence that if God speaks to you, that he has the answer and he will give you the right direction. And I know young people at this stage, when you're young, you've got so many decisions to make. And it's great to ask your parents. It's great to ask your vocational guidance people and all these people that are there. But at the end of the day, God knows your path from the beginning to the end. And if you listen to his voice, you'll stop. You will avoid a lot of stupid situations that I got into by listening to the wrong voice. There's a beautiful Bible verse that just says, in fact, I'll read it out to you. Okay, it's Psalm 119, verse 105. And it says quite simply, your word, that is God's word, is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. Now, a lamp you hold down to the ground, close to the ground. It doesn't show you very far, but it does help you avoid all the potholes and problems, curbs that you're going to fall over. And it is a light to your path. We don't see the end because a light doesn't go that far, but God has an end for you. If you follow his lamp in all the small decisions, he will look after the big decisions.
Thank you. When we're following Jesus' footsteps, we need to make sure we're listening to him. So thank you for that reminder, Paul. We're now going to hear from the songsters with their message. Thank you for that. How beautiful. I love that song. It's that reminder to abide with Jesus, and Jesus will abide with us. It's beautiful. So we're talking about following in the footsteps of Jesus. And we've heard that following in the footsteps of Jesus is about listening to him. But I want to say that following in the footsteps of Jesus is also learning about Jesus. So Job 23 verse 11 says, I followed him closely, my feet in his footprints. I love that. I followed him closely, my feet in his footprints. The first disciples of Jesus were able to literally follow Jesus in his footsteps. And they did. They followed him closely, learning to walk, talk, think, and live like Jesus. It's not quite the same for us today, is it? We don't have those footsteps right in front of us. But Jesus did leave footprints behind. He set an example for us to follow. Psalm 119 verse 15 says this, I will study your teachings and follow your footsteps. I will study your teachings and follow your footsteps. So I want you to have a chat around your tables, okay? And I want you to chat around and share one way that you learn about Jesus and his ways. So what's one way that you learn about Jesus and his ways? To help you with this, there is some questions on the table. So I have given you a bit of a sneak peek there. So it looks like, it looks like this, all right? And it says scripture songs, books and podcasts, websites, apps, social medias, teachers and role models. And while you're doing that, there's some slips of paper on the table. Might you get you to write them on the slips? I'll get you to write them on the slips, these ones here. All right? And then after a few minutes, I'm going to get the kids to run around and pick them up for me. So if you can put a little dab of blue tack on the back of your slips. So write some stuff out on these little slips. Put a dab of blue tack on it. I'm going to get the kids to bring them out. So you can write as many as you want, all the different ways that help you learn about Jesus. Thank you.
Wow, our board is looking pretty amazing up here. I might start reading them out, and Sienna's doing a great job of grabbing them all. Look at all the different ways that we can learn about Jesus. All right, let me have a look. Reading the Bible, that's a good way. The Bible stories and songs. I love it when a Bible story can just relate so well. Jesus was really good at relating to our lives, wasn't he? The song, I'm Living My Life for Jesus. It's a beautiful song. It's a great one. Good reminder, isn't it? Plenty of songs from the gems. Well, this one's good. I can learn about Jesus from the web, but I can learn about the correct and incorrect biblical teaching. Some wisdom there in what we learn is good, isn't it? Spending time daily in the Word of God. Worship songs speak the name of Jesus. The song, I'm in His hands. That's a beautiful one, isn't it? I love the line, no matter what the future holds, I'm in His hands. And we're in uncertain days, aren't we? Better when we know we're in Jesus' hands. The song, King of Kings. Friends and family that I trust, read stories, attend church, Bible groups. The song number 425, Living Beneath the Shade of the Cross. Wow. Whew, look at all these ways that we can learn about Jesus. Parents, Veggie Tales. Nice. I love a good Veggie Tales. Kids' Bibles. Listening to worship music on YouTube, daily Bible reading, prayer, sermons on Sundays. I saw that a few times, actually, learning from your minister. So they're learning something, Roderick, which is good. Life group, church, music. I have decided to follow Jesus. Shine, Jesus, shine, my lighthouse. The Bible app. There's some really good apps out there now for reading your Bible. There's this beautiful one called Lectio 365 and gives you a daily Bible reading and meditation from the Word, and it's just a beautiful one. Oh, this is good. Dad, Roderick Brown, Narelle, and everyone who wrote the Bible. We're in good company there. Listening to the experiences of others, reflecting on situations to learn where God stepped in, observing my surroundings to recognize God's influence. It's beautiful. Talking with fellow Christian believers with the Word of God, praying with brothers and sisters, Christian role models, the Psalms, music and songs,
Oh, here we go. Kids church leaders as well. So you're up there with the list of reverends, ministers and officers, everyone at church. I'm going to miss ones, I know. God hath shined in our hearts. Nice. Reading the Bible every morning. Apps, life group, attending church. I'm sure I've missed some there. But isn't that a beautiful picture when we look at all that, of all the ways that we can learn of Jesus? So even when we physically can't walk in the footsteps of Jesus and see him every day physically with us, we know God is with us. And we've still got his footprints here that we can keep learning about him. And you know what? We all learn in different ways anyway. Did anybody here go to university or at university still? So you went to your uni and you learned from there? Did anybody here get an apprentice straight out of school? Yep, we've got some apprentices. So you might have learnt your trade in a different way. We all learn in different ways. Some people may not have even gone on to further study but found a job, or they might have just become the best parent they could have ever been in their household, and they learnt. I think a lot of parents just learn on the job, don't they? That's what I'm noticing with my friends. You just learn, you make it happen, you find out from other people around you how to do it. We all learn in different ways. I remember I learned from my grandma how to knit by her just sitting next to me and showing me. But you know what she did? She never taught me how to cast on. She always did that for herself. So my skills now are completely useless because I didn't learn the full picture. Kids, YouTube. Have you learned anything from YouTube lately? Or TikTok? It's where you go to learn things, right? YouTube and TikTok now. So my grandma never taught me how to cast on, so I can't knit. But lately I decided I wanted to learn how to crochet. So I went to TikTok, and TikTok taught me how to crochet. Not well yet, but I'm going to get there. If anyone here knows how to crochet and I can sit down with you, probably a better way of learning. But this just shows us all the different ways that we can learn about Jesus and how important it is for us to follow him in God's footsteps, to continually learn. And there's always something more that we can learn. I'm going to get the kids' ministry leaders to jump up the front. So, Angela, and anybody else that ever helps Angela in any way, because I know you take the brunt of it, but I think your parents help out a bit. Yeah? Does Kelly and Roderick help out a bit, right? Like, they help, so. Yeah, you guys help. Come on down. Your sister helps? I'm going to get you to blow some bubbles for me. You might have to share them around. Yep. So you can blow or you can move, whichever one. It might be easier to move without a bit of water. Beautiful bubbles, nice. So our kids ministry workers and anyone that helps in the process, because it's not just your upfront person these days, there's a lot going on with the admin of it and making sure everyone's safe and all that. So our kids ministry workers work alongside children all the time, helping them to follow Jesus. They leave footprints in the lives of the children to help them follow Jesus. So as they're blowing bubbles, we see the bubbles. And the bubbles are there for a while, aren't they? But then what happens with a bubble? It bursts. It goes. It ruptures. It doesn't stick around forever, does it? They're there for a moment. And then they're gone. All right. It is fun, isn't it? Bubbles are great. Have you ever seen a little puppy with bubbles? They're great. They just love to yap at them. Might you get to stop the bubbles for a moment? Because they're there and then they're gone. And they're only there for a moment. The bubbles, they don't last forever. But I just want to say to you all, your investment in children, it lasts forever. It's not like the bubbles. Investing in children and in their relationship with Jesus is a lasting impact on them. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, "For the things we see now will soon be gone, just like the bubbles. But the things we cannot see will last forever. So sometimes you might feel like you're blowing bubbles and can't see any results. But what you do each week is leaving footprints that help others follow Jesus, making lasting impact on children's and their lives and their families. So I thank God for your creativity, your energy, your preparation, the stuff that people don't see in the background, your prayers for their children, your love for Jesus is obvious as you share Jesus every week. I wonder if we can all thank these guys by a big clap for what they do every week with their kids. Yeah. And I'm going to pray for them all. God, I just want to thank you for Angela, and I just thank you, God, that for all that she does for the kids in this church, that she loves them, she prays for them, and she teaches them, but most importantly, she shows them what it is to live a life that follows you. I thank you for everyone else up here, Lord God, as those that are cheering her on in the admin and the day-to-day stuff and the stuff that just goes on behind the scenes. For Candace as well, who can't be here today, God, we just pray for her. And we just thank you for their investment in the lives of kids. I pray that you'll give them an extra special blessing today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all. Bubbles are fun, aren't they? So we've talked about listening to Jesus, and we've talked about learning about Jesus, but now we're going to talk about leading others towards Jesus. When we follow Jesus, we leave footprints and help others to follow Jesus. So Max Lucado says this: in our faith, we follow in someone's steps. In our faith, we leave footprints to guide others. It's the principle of discipleship. We follow in Jesus' footsteps, but we leave footprints for others to follow as well. The 12 disciples of Jesus went on to spread his teachings far and wide. After his death, they continued to set an example and lead others in the ways of Jesus. As disciples of Jesus, we follow and we lead. So what does it mean for us to follow Jesus' footsteps? We cannot do like the disciples almost 2,000 years ago did, but we can learn from his teachings and live a life of a child of God just like him. The Bible shows us many of Jesus' teachings, and fellow disciples can share stories about how they follow Jesus. Have you ever noticed that Jesus chose 12 disciples in the beginning, and that group of followers became bigger and bigger? Apparently, Jesus wants us to journey together with others. So stay close to those who show you how to follow Jesus, and stay close to Jesus himself through prayer and times of solitude. If you really want to see where Jesus wants to lead you, you need to stay close to Jesus. And you need to know who's coming behind you. It might be someone younger than you, but it might be someone older than you. You can lead people of all ages in the ways of Jesus. If someone is following in your footsteps, will that pathway lead them to Jesus? Are you living your life in a way that shows others how to live like Jesus? Got some paper on the table and some texters. If you want to take a print of your foot, feel free to put the paper on the floor and trace around your foot. If you would prefer to use a handprint, feel free to use a handprint. There's options here. So you can put your foot on the paper and trace around if you want to, but you've also got the things for a handprint. I thought we might want a hand option. So with the paper provided, make a tracing of your hand or your foot, whichever one you want. Now, I don't know about you, but we've all got significant marks on our hands, don't we? I've got this beautiful scar across the bottom here, and that just tells a story of my life, that things happen in life, don't they? There's bits and bobs, there's places that are calloused and hard. Draw on your hand, draw on the paper hand or foot if you've gone foot, just the significant markings of your hand, the things that life has done to you, things that make your story your story. If you've drawn your scars, your calluses, your lines, the things that make your hand, then I want you to write your name across the top. So I'm going to write my name across the top of mine. And then I'm going to get you each on your fingers or your toes. I'm going to get you to write some prayers or some ways that you want to lead others in the ways of Jesus. So I've written here my family's names as people that I just want to be praying for and be leading in the way of Jesus or influencing in the way of Jesus. I might write people at my workplace. Or it might be a job that I want to have one day. I might want to be a lawyer so I can help others and help them have a better life because that's what Jesus wants for them. So different prayers that you have along your fingers for people in your life, for things you want to do, the way you want to impact others for Jesus. Take a couple of minutes to do that. Right. I'm going to pray, and as I pray, I'm going to leave a little bit of a moment in there for you to pray for those things that are on your hand. Let's pray together. God, I just want to thank you for our lives, and one that we get to walk alongside you in the midst of the craziness of everything. And I just thank you that you're always with us. But God, in the way that you've made our lives, there's things in our lives that we just want to hand back to you because we want to be the best influence we can be. So for those things on our hand right now, our jobs, our family, our friends, all the things in our life and the places we can be an influence for you, we hand them to you right now and just ask us to show us again how we can live your way better in this life. Just leave it quiet for 30 seconds so you can bring the things in your hand to God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, we need to listen to Jesus, we need to learn about Jesus, and we need to show others the way of Jesus. We're going to finish up by singing the song. Speak Jesus. Yeah. I lost my... I thought that was... We're going to finish by singing the song Speak Jesus. And this is a song about speaking the love of Jesus and the name of Jesus over the people in our lives. So let's stand up, let's sing this together. But let's be singing over our generations as well, the ones that are coming.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
And as we go out this week into the world, I just pray that you would know that God is with you, is before you, has walked this path and is walking with you, and you can follow in his footsteps. Amen.